So we have been looking at Kalman filter, and in my last lecture I did a derivation. So those of you who could not attend it should have a look at CD web page for listening to the lecture. So what I'll just take a very quick recap of what we have shown in the last lecture. Well, one thing is if you make an assumption that state noise, measurement noise and the initial guess for the state, all of them have Gaussian distributions. State noise and measurement noise are Gaussian white noise processes, and initial estimate or initial at time 0, the estimate has a Gaussian distribution. Then what we have shown is that Kalman filter gives you a maximum likelihood estimate. It also gives you a maximum a posteriori estimate, the value that or the vector that maximizes a posteriori density function. One nice thing about Gaussian distributions is that if state noise and measurement noise are Gaussian white noise processes and initial condition is a white noise, then all the conditional densities of x k given y k minus 1 or x k given y k, they are also Gaussian processes. So they also have Gaussian densities. They are not Gaussian processes, but they have Gaussian densities. You can show that distribution of them is Gaussian. Then Kalman filter can be derived without making any assumption about density. So you don't have to make an assumption about Gaussianity. You can derive Kalman filter just using arguments of minimum variance, okay, minimum covariance. So trace of covariance matrix we minimized with respect to the gain matrix, and we still get the same thing. So one of the beauty of this result is that it can be derived by multiple viewpoints and you get the same result. If you start from just optimization viewpoint, just minimizing a scalar objective function, minimize the trace of the covariance matrix, you get exactly the same estimate which you would get if you were to start with Gaussian assumption and then looking at you know, which estimate maximizes the likelihood function or which estimate gives you maximum of posterior density. All of them just give you same result. So different viewpoints just collapse into one single result, okay. Why this result is important? Because it is recursive. It is, it systematically takes into account how the noise or uncertainty in the state dynamics and uncertainty in the measurement are systematically taken into account. Yeah. Yeah. Here when we come to stationary observer, we need some assumptions of that sort. But here the stability can be shown without requiring observability assumption. So observability assumptions are required if you look at stability by not ignoring. I have looked at stability only one limited viewpoint, only error in the initial state. I think when you go to input to state stability, you may require observability condition, or observability condition may be required for existence of the Kalman gain. That I have to check where the observability condition comes into picture here. So nice thing about Kalman filter is that you only work with first and second moments of the distribution, whether it is Gaussian or non-Gaussian. You just keep working with first moment, second moment, and it is very easy to do calculations. And this is much easier than doing pole placement, because how do you choose the poles if you happen to know WK and VK to be Gaussian white noise processes is not clear, okay. So that that part is not clear. So, this gives you a very systematic way of handling. We also looked at convergence of errors and then looked at it as a deterministic linear system, and then what I showed was that you can construct a Lyapunov function and you just consider the error in the initial condition and it will converge. The difference between the true state and the estimated state will asymptotically go to 0, and this we did using you know, this is the just summary of the Kalman filter, but here I am not looking at WK and VK, yet I am using same update equations which are used for the Kalman gain. Here you can look at Q and R to be two tuning matrices which are positive definite, okay, and then you can actually show that one can construct the error dynamics is given by this equation. This we have already derived earlier, and this difference equation actually is asymptotically stable that I have shown using this matrix inversion lemma, and then constructing a Lyapunov function which is, so construct, so we have defined this pi k here, pi k is inverse of covariance matrix. Using inverse of covariance matrix we have constructed a Lyapunov function and then shown that this Lyapunov function is negative definite, moreover under certain assumptions you can show that this is a asymptotically stable system. So observer is stable, okay. So actually in this case we designed an observer first for the performance. How was the performance defined? Performance was defined using minimum variance, and then now I am showing that the designed observer turns out to be stable, okay. Just going back here to this difference equation, why did I have to use, I had to analyze stability of this difference equation, this particular difference equation here, combined difference equation. Now for this combined difference equation I could not use the condition that eigenvalues inside the unit circle. Why? What was the problem? Why I couldn't do that? Because it is time varying system. This matrix here, phi times LK, C is constant, phi is constant, LK is not constant, LK is time varying. So this is a linear system but with time varying matrix phi. Phi means if you call this whole thing as some phi tilde, this combined matrix you cannot look at its eigenvalue because it is not constant with time, it is changing. So you cannot use eigenvalue analysis here. I had to resort to use of Lyapunov functions, okay. So indirectly it also demonstrates how Lyapunov functions can be used, very powerful theory. So that is why I didn't talk about spectral radius less than 1, eigenvalue less than 1, because here you know it's this matrix, combined matrix phi times I minus L star K C is changing with time, okay. So each one of them will have different eigenvalues, and then you cannot say that if all of them are inside unit circle you cannot prove that, then system is stable, that cannot be proved, okay. So such a condition doesn't exist, okay. If this matrix is constant, it doesn't change with time, you can use that condition of inside unit circle, that is that condition holds for linear time invariant and discrete time systems, okay. So that's why I had to resort to Lyapunov functions, and then I just showed that I can construct a Lyapunov function using covariance inverse, a distance measure using covariance inverse, and then if you see this VK is error transpose covariance inverse into error. Actually this term appears also in the Gaussian density function e to the power, same term. So I just showed that this is VK plus 1 minus VK is always negative definite, and this means that the error asymptotically goes to 0. So we have at least under limited conditions we have showed asymptotic convergence of Kalman filter, okay. I have not touched upon here what happens. I have made a simplifying assumption that WK and VK are 0. To treat it under Lyapunov framework when WK and VK are not 0 is possible under certain modifications. there is you can in Lyapunov function theory or Lyapunov stability theory, there is something called input to state stability. So you can also talk about unforced. We talked about unforced stability here. You can also talk about stability when there are external disturbances like WK and VK. But then the maths becomes much more complex. I don't want to get into that right now. So at least for limited case, I have shown that it is stable. Okay. Okay. So now I just want to move ahead from here, and what I want to do now is to make a connection with time series models. Okay. When I started looking at these two things, Kalman filter and time series models, the books written on time series models and books written on Kalman filter are by two different proponents. One kind of people who more believe in first principle models, and then Kalman filtering is used there with mechanistic models, whereas time series models come from completely different angle, and there is a deeper connection, and many times this is not highlighted sufficiently in many of the books. But actually, if you see what is the connection, then you will be able to appreciate what's happening much better. If you remember, when we developed all those ARMAX, ARX, those kind of models, attempt was to capture effect of unknown disturbances, unmeasured disturbances. Okay. In Kalman filter too, you have two unknown disturbances, WK and VK. Okay. And attempt is to capture the effect of WK and remove VK, and so something similar is happening. We need to connect and see what is the connection. Okay. Now I want to first talk about this concept of stationary Kalman filter. Now stationary Kalman filter is what you typically see is that when k goes to infinity, this pk given k minus 1 and pk given k do not change with time. They go to a stationary solution. Okay. And this stationary solution, I am denoting it by p tilde. I am calling it p tilde because this is k given k minus 1, and I am calling this just p infinity. Okay. So when you go to Kalman filter, these are difference equations. If you look at these equations, these are difference equations. Okay. These are connected difference equations, this and this. They are difference equations in time. Okay. And then just like a linear system will have a stable solution, this is a linear difference equation. It will have it's a linear difference equation, and it actually asymptotically, under certain conditions, the solutions asymptotically converge to steady state. Okay. The steady state I am denoting by p tilde infinity, p infinity, and l star infinity. Now l star infinity is called as this L star is called a steady state Kalman gain, which means after some time, when you do programming, now my next computing assignment is that for the given system, you are supposed to implement Leuenberger observer and Kalman filter. Input to be given is PRBS again. Okay, start from an initial condition which is for the observer. Start from an initial condition different from the plant, and see whether the observer converges to the truth. Okay. So this is the next assignment. I will put it on the Moodle today, but now the idea is that once we have this simulator, you can do everything that we have learned in the class. So just now next submission is implement Leuenberger observer and Kalman filter on that particular system on which you are studying. Okay. And there you will notice this when you actually program, you see that if you actually keep track of how gain is changing, after some time this gain becomes constant. Okay, gain doesn't change with time, and that particular gain is this. Now Actually, you can write down the equations, the steady state equations, okay. These are called as algebraic Riccati equations, the original equations which we use to find the covariance matrix and the Kalman gain are called as Riccati equations, and these are called as algebraic Riccati equations because there is no time involved here in algebraic Riccati equations. I am just writing the same equations at the steady state. So these are coupled matrix equations, okay, and there has been lot of literature on how to solve this, particularly when the dimension becomes large, it becomes a complex problem, and probably large part of 60s, 70s, lot of work went on how to solve algebraic Riccati equations, how to solve. So actually now my prediction and update is, prediction of course is given by this, there is no gain involved here. Update is given by a constant matrix, which is now I am just showing you quadruple tank system, okay, which we have been looking at as a theme example. The I have taken covariance Q to be 0.01, 0.01. So Q is a diagonal matrix. I assume that there is uncertainty in each of the states, not entering through any input, but general uncertainty in each of the states, whose covariance is given by this particular matrix, and R is the, there is an error in the measurement whose covariance is again given by 0.01, 0.01. I have just taken some sample values, it is not that, so that sufficiently there is large unknown component. Now, I just put our final steady state solution because it is difficult to show all possible Lk varying as a function of time. There are many Lk varying as a function of time. As k goes to infinity, you get this, probably we can see that it actually Kalman gain goes to, let me just show you first these results. You can see here that this is the estimate, this is the perturbation model. Initial estimate I gave for the perturbation model to be 0, 0, okay. The true state is 2 minus 2, see I have, the true state is 2 minus 2, 2 minus 2, okay. Initial value or initial guess for the observer, I have to give an initial guess for the observer. I have given it to be 0, 0, okay. The noise is there, okay, and then I have to, I have to compare, since I am doing an experiment in my computer, I can compare the truth with the estimate, okay. Now these two, level 1 and level 2 are measured, level 3 and level 4 are not measured, okay. So level 1 and level 2, you know, there is no wonder that this starts following each other. But look at level 3 and level 4, level 3 and level 4 are not measured. So this is the comparison between the estimate, this green is an estimate, and this is the truth, okay. So this gives you a least square estimate, you have to understand. You are never going to recover the truth. This is the estimate that minimizes variance or covariance matrix, okay. So the green is an estimate of level 3 and level 4. If I want to use it for control, I can use it because after some time, the mean value is exactly following. You see this? So here you get a least square estimate, minimum variance estimate. So it is not a true value. Okay. I just told you that covariance, when you do an update, the covariance of the updated state is smaller than the covariance of the predicted state. All that I have done here is I have plotted the spectral radius of the covariance matrices, updated covariance matrix and predicted covariance matrix, okay. You can see that when you do update, the covariance reduces, spectral radius reduces. If the spectral radius reduces, which means the covariance reduces, okay, because for a 4 cross 4 matrix to show that it reduces is difficult. So I have used the spectral radius as a measure, because this is a positive definite matrix, all eigenvalues are positive, okay. Smaller spectral radius means the covariance is reducing. So this is a demonstration of, let's see how the code looks like, and let me see if I can demonstrate that Kalman filter actually goes to steady state after some time, P matrix goes to steady state. So now for the observer case, I am not going to post my code, okay, you can see it here, but you have to write it on your own, understand and write it. Okay, so my Kalman filter is a slightly older program, but what you have to understand is that at kth instant, when I get a measurement, I do all the calculations for Kalman filter. So this is my PK1 is my predicted covariance update. This is my Kalman gain calculation, PK1 into CMAT into inverse of VK. Then I do a correction here. Oh, this is the prediction. I compute the covariance, I compute the innovation, EK is YK is the measurement which is coming from the plant, and CMAT into X hat K is the estimate, and this LK times EK, LK is the Kalman gain which has been computed here, LK times EK is where you are doing the update, and this is the prediction, this is the updated covariance, PK is function of PK minus 1. So these are the calculations that are done for Kalman filter, okay. This is, see, you have to understand how a digital control system works to implement this. At kth instant, when I receive a measurement, immediately I do these calculations. It is assumed that it is almost instantaneous, at least relatively instantaneous compared to the gap between the two samples, okay. So these calculations have to be done, and then I send the whatever input that goes to the plant. This is plant simulation and this is observer simulation. So this is observer and this is plant. This is plant, okay. And then we can actually check how these matrices change as a function of time. So let us start tracking them. So let me say here, to begin with, we will put or we will do it from the here, it is PK1, then PK and LK, and I will put a pause. So you will see that as we run this program, okay, this is the observability matrix and its rank is 4, okay. So I am just showing you how PK is changing with time and LK is changing with time. You see that right now PK, okay, let's do it, let's put them side by side, PK and PK minus 1. Let's put them so that okay, so you see how this covariance has changed with time. So Q and R matrices are given, and then okay. So this is my, so this part is my initial PK given K minus 1, this is PK given K, this is updated covariance, this part, and this part is predicted covariance, and LK is the Kalman gain. Now you will notice that these values will start changing as a function of time. So this again, this is the predicted covariance, this is the updated covariance, and so on. And asymptotically, this equations will, if you see the values here, let's just look at the diagonal values. The diagonal values are reducing, and that too, the diagonal values of the predicted covariance are higher than the diagonal values of the updated covariance, okay. So every time you do update, the covariance reduces, the error reduces, okay. and Kalman gain is changing as a function of time, but after some time it will go to a steady state. Now if you see this matrix and this matrix, just look at diagonal values, they are not different from the previous time. This LK is not changing. So within some 20 samples, the Kalman gain has converged to LK star or LK infinity. Okay, covariances have converged to their respective steady state values. Okay, so this is so after some time, see this change in covariance is occurring only in initial period. After some time, you know, it's going to a steady state. So one might say that why do you want to program, you know, if I am running a Kalman filter for a very long time, only suppose initial 100, 200 samples Kalman gain is going to change. Okay, instead of doing this programming for, you know, time varying Kalman gain which is going to change only first few instances, just take the steady state value and use it. Practical approach, it can do it. So you can just solve the algebraic Riccati equations, get the steady state Kalman gain and use it, and you will get good, okay. So instead of doing this programming in which covariance change, LK change and then they go to steady state, you could directly choose to solve steady state Kalman gain equation. The MATLAB gives you a solution if you want for the steady state algebraic Riccati equation. And again, you can directly get the Kalman gain and use it for, so let us move back to, is everyone clear about what is done? So the observer is run parallel to the plant, okay. So when you code, when you write program, you have to run at kth instant, you have to get a measurement, write the observer. K to k plus 1, you get new measurements created here. When you move from k to k plus 1, then this measurement, this is a loop, this is a loop, this loop comes back to observer again, okay. New measurement comes, you do estimate and you know it is running parallel to the plant, okay. That's what, that's how you implement this, okay. And that you can see from this graph also. See what is the meaning of, if you see here initial period, this spectral radius is changing. After some time it has stabilized, okay. Spectral radius is not changing, which means pk given k minus 1 and pk given k have become constant after some time. They are not changing with time, they have just stabilized. It is a stable solution, okay. Now what if your model is not correct, there is some mismatch in the model, what if there is some disturbance, or one of the simplest problem is suppose A and phi and gamma matrices are correct and C matrices, but and the measurement noise typically is a Gaussian noise, measurement noise is not a problem, but the state noise being a Gaussian white noise process or a white noise process is a very simplistic assumption. Sometimes or oftentimes the noise entering the state dynamics is colored, okay. It is like a drifting signal, and so even though you have very elegant solution when you assume it to be a white noise, okay, mathematically very convenient. See many times we make simplifications so that you know you get some mathematically elegant solutions, but then you start from that, you get some understanding there, and then you start going towards the reality, you know, you relax some of the assumptions, and then you, so one of the things that is done is that suppose this WK we assume to be white noise, we modeled an unknown disturbance using two components. We modeled this using another component here, I am another additional, I would say artificial state neta here. Sometimes this is artificial, sometimes you could relate it to a real problem, real disturbances. And then this gamma neta is some kind of a tuning matrix. So this omega is again artificially introduced, this omega is a white noise. So what you are saying is that there is another disturbance which is like integrated white noise. Integrated white noise is random walk model. See, this is neta k plus 1 is old value plus a white noise. So this is like an integrated white noise. This is like a drifting behavior. This is the most commonly used model when you want to model disturbances which are unknown but drifting. Simplest model to use, okay. And so this kind of a model is used to take care of the fact that the state disturbances need not be white. So this is white noise and this is called as integrated white noise. Why integrated white noise? Because this is an integrator, neta k plus 1, new value is old value plus noise. This is simple integration. Last value is equal to, see, integration, I don't know whether you have done this derivation for you know, PI controller, discretizing a PI controller. See, I suppose I am just giving you a parallel, another example, so that you will appreciate why this is an integrator. See, suppose I have this term, you know, say u t is equal to integral 0 to t f t dt, okay. So this I can approximate as summation I going from or k going from 0 to say n, there are n samples from 0 to t f k, and dt I will take sampling interval to be t, okay. So this integral I can, if dt is nothing but the sampling interval and fk is the value this function takes at discrete time points, and if these samples are very very close, I can write this integral like this, okay. But then what you can do is that u t plus cap t is 0 to t plus t, which is ft dt, and I can approximate this as summation k going from 0 to n plus 1 fk into t, right. I have advanced by one sampling interval, okay. T is my sampling interval, I have advanced by one sampling interval. So this is integral from 0 to n, where n is equal to t by okay, n is equal to n samples takes you to time small t, and n plus 1 samples take you to time t plus capital T, okay. So this small t plus capital T. So now one way to write this is to see, suppose you take this as equation 1 and you take this as equation 2, okay. I can subtract, you know, subtracting 1 from 2, you will get u t plus capital T minus u t is equal to, see, this is summation up to n, this is summation up to n plus 1. So if you subtract, what will remain? Only one term will remain, okay. So that will be f of f at k into t. So I can write this equation as u t plus capital T is equal to u t plus f k into t, or in other words, u k plus 1 is equal to u k plus something. So integrator, a integrator in discrete time can be written like this, okay. This u is an integration of all the values in the past, so I am writing an integrator in a different way. So coming back to our equation here, this is an integrator, okay. Neta k plus 1 is equal to old value of neta plus correction. Now this correction is artificially introduced white noise, so it is like a drift, okay. It is a drifting behavior. So if I want to model state disturbances which are not simplistic white noise model, then you can augment this. This is the common trick, because you have to be able to model those unmeasured disturbances. There are ways by which you can do it slightly differently, and we will see that soon. So this Q is then you know you augment this system, you have a new state space model, xk plus 1, neta k plus 1 together become a new state, and then you can work with Kalman filter for the augmented system. So you can design a Kalman filter for the augmented system, and typically in such case this Q neta is treated as a tuning parameter to make sure that the drifting disturbances are modeled, and then how to use this tuning parameter will require some experience. It's not straightforward. Yeah. So W term will be there, no? W will get modeled through Q. So I am saying that it is addition of white noise plus integrating white noise. W. Here. W neta. That's a artificially introduced tuning white noise. No, it is not same as WK. Yeah. So this is something which is a artifact of a modeling. It is just trying to capture a drifting noise as a combination of integrated white noise and a white noise. This is integrated white noise. This is white noise, and then attempt to merge the two into a. Let's go over the Kalman filter summary. We have to have initialization. We have to have initial guess. When you start, you have to kick off your Kalman filter. You need an initial guess of the initial state. You'll also have to give a initial covariance. This is typically given some alpha times I, where alpha is a large value. Okay, you covariance, large initial covariance means you are not sure about the state guess that you are giving. If you are pretty sure about a guess that you are giving, you can give a small value of this alpha times I. This alpha can be small. So this is a kind of a tuning parameter. When you actually start a Kalman filter, what should be the initial covariance? You have to give a guess, and this P naught actually will tell what trust you place in your guess. Okay, if you give large P naught, which means you don't trust your covariance is large, means you don't trust your initial guess. Covariance if you give small, which means you have a reasonable guess. Okay, then the at kth time step, the thing that you have to do is to compute Kalman gain, then do this recursive estimation, and I'm talking about the prediction estimate here. 1 minute. Let us revisit this. Well, some time back, if you remember, I talked about two different types of estimators. When we talked about Leuenberger observer, we first developed this prediction estimator, if you remember. And then I said there is a filter estimator. Prediction estimator is using one. There is one time delay between the estimate and y, okay. And then we had this current state estimator. Current state estimator was prediction step and then a correction step, right. So there are there in Leuenberger observer, I first derived the prediction estimator, and then I showed how you can use the correction filter estimator. In Kalman filter, I first derived the filter, Kalman filter. I can also derive Kalman predictor, one step predictor. Okay. So I am not giving you the derivation, I am directly giving you the final form here. You can look at Astroman Witten mark for derivation, which runs very, very similar to what we have done. Slight algebra is different, but the final form is more or less the same. I mean the ideas in the derivation are more or less the same, and final form of the equations is slightly different. So in this case, prediction estimator, I compute the Kalman gain. Okay, I have a prediction estimate, which means k plus 1 is LP star, just like we had prediction Leuenberger observer. This is prediction Kalman filter, Kalman predictor. This is Kalman predictor. Okay, and the update, there is only one covariance update. There are no two different, there is nothing like, prediction correction. There is only one step. So again, you will ask why will you use this and why not the Kalman filter? It depends upon how much computation time you have. You have to understand that you have to do these calculations of matrix multiplications and, gain update, inverse or whatever is involved in real time. And it depends upon which system you are trying to use this observer. If your system is very, very fast, if you have to do millisecond calculations, and if you have a processor which is, onboard processor is not so powerful, then you might resort to prediction, because in prediction, you can do these calculations between the two samples, keep gain ready, and when the measurement comes, you can just, at the instant when you want to use observer, you can just use the prediction estimate and don't wait for calculations to be over at a given sampling instant. So that is where the prediction estimator is useful. Another reason I am talking about prediction estimator will become clear very, very soon. But is the idea clear? Is what, just like we had prediction Leonberger observer, this is prediction Kalman predictor. Okay, this is Kalman predictor, and there is only one covariance. There is only one covariance because we do not have prediction correction step, there is only prediction step. Okay, and this is the new covariance from the old covariance. This is how you calculate the Kalman gain for this case. The Kalman gain and for the prediction case and the Kalman gain for the filter case only differ through this phi. Okay, if you compare the values, if you have the notes, you can find out and see the how the values compare. Only this phi will come extra here. So I am just showing you how a Kalman predictor would look like. This is for the CSTR example, the reactor example. This is my model. I have developed a Kalman predictor here. The steady state predictor will look like this, and I am trying to estimate concentration from temperature, and very quickly the observer error goes to zero. And since I am doing simulations, I can actually compare the truth with the estimated value, and you can see here that the estimated concentration and the true concentration are almost sitting on the top of each other. So you get very good estimates very quickly. So the error is, initial error is large, but after that it converges. This is like a zero mean error, and you get a mean value estimate through this. So the point is, see, now in the reactor I want to control the composition. Okay, now once this observer has settled, I can develop, even before you go to the advanced control, I can develop a simple PID controller. Okay, that will measure concentration. What do you mean by measure concentration? Actually, physically you are measuring a temperature, then you give that temperature measurement to this observer. Observer will reconstruct concentration estimate, and then based on the concentration estimate you will do the control. So you close the loop using estimated state. Okay, so this Kalman filter is actually acting as a soft sensor. Okay, so actually in some sense, after these microprocessors have become so powerful, and you can use calculations, do calculations online, the combination of real sensors which give you fast measurement of some physical variables which can be measured, together with these model based sensor, has expanded the possibility of measurement far beyond what was possible say 30-40 years back, when you could not use an onboard computer. Now you can put an onboard computer on a on a device, and you can have these soft measurements coming up. So model based sensing, I would call it model based sensing, is a very, 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 very rich area used in many different fields of engineering. Okay. Now, the question is under what conditions the solutions of Riccati equations exist and when will you get a stable solution? So, you can show that under weak conditions, if this pair phi and square root of q is stabilizable. Now, what is stabilizable? I am going to talk about it possibly in today's class. But right now, just accept this theorem, and if phi and c are detectable, a weaker form of observability, then you can show that the solution of Kalman predictor always exists, and you will get this is about the steady state solution. So you can actually come up with algebraic criteria. This is for the Kalman predictor. Just like we can have stationary Kalman filter, you can have stationary Kalman predictor, and this gives you conditions under which the solution, or you can find a stationary Kalman predictor which is stabilizing. So that means the error will go to zero. Okay. So right now, all the things that are needed to understand this I have not covered, but I am stating it here for the completeness. Maybe as we progress, we will be able to collate and understand this. The reason I am talking about the steady state Kalman predictor is this. Now, this is my steady state Kalman predictor. As k goes to infinity, pk given k minus will go to p infinity. Let us call it p infinity here. This p infinity is the solution of this algebraic Riccati equations. These are two coupled equations. If you see here, this p infinity is a function of p infinity plus lp, but lp itself is a function of p infinity. Okay. So, you can actually eliminate and combine into one equation, one big equation, and solution of this is the steady state Kalman predictor. And steady state Kalman predictor, when does the solution exist for this particular, this is a tough equation to solve, because just remember these are matrices, all these are matrices. Okay. And then you have a problem here, because this p infinity appears here nicely as multiplicative, but when you go to lp, there is an inverse of p infinity coming up here. Okay. So solving this problem, getting a solution for this problem is not trivial. Okay. Fortunately, now MATLAB gives you a solution of, I think there is a subroutine called ARE, algebraic Riccati equation. Okay. So you just give phi and c and say ARE, it will give you Kalman gains. Okay. So you don't have to do much now to solve those algebraic Riccati equations. You just give p, q, phi, c, okay, and say ARE. And if you don't have MATLAB, you can use Scilab, so which is a public domain software, and you can install it on your machine, and then you can get going. You can design a Kalman filter. So any one of these standard, or you can write your own tiny code, and you saw that it goes to steady state. So even if you don't have ARE, okay, you write your tiny code for the observer. After some 100 samples, you will get the steady state solution. Okay, so no problem. You are in business if you just have some computer with you, and routines for matrix multiplication, and well, also inversion. Mind you, these things, these things can become complex when you miniaturize. You want to have embedded observer. It can be complex because we on a computer assume that inversion can be done very easily. If you want to do it on some microcontroller, writing where floating point, computation support may not be available, or may not be so powerful. Then doing matrix computations, then doing matrix inversion is not a joke. Using a computer, but computers are relatively slower, okay, and difficult to use for very fast systems. So on embedded computing, even though these things look very simple on a computer, PC, laptop, they are not easy when you go to embedded control. But But if I want to see what is the advantage of designing this LP infinity, what is the computational advantage? Online, there is no every time calculation. You compute this once offline, you design this LP0, and then you know this step involves only this computation. So online matrix computations all are gone, and anyway you know after some time it stabilizes to LP infinity, use that LP infinity and you know solve the problem. So straightforward way of, so this is much more practical in to have a stationary Kalman filter and then use it, but in the assignment you are not going to do stationary Kalman filter, you are going to use the very change with function of time. Okay, now what I want to do is I want to connect, I want to show that stationary Kalman predictor is nothing but Box-Jenkins model, nothing but a form of Box-Jenkins model or time series model. So you know we just close the loop, and other way of looking at it is that Box-Jenkins model or Armax model is a parameterization of stationary Kalman filter, that is another viewpoint. Okay, so look at this stationary form of the Kalman filter. Now instead of calling it L star, I am just, see this is what we had, right? If you look at this last equation, x hat k plus 1 is phi x hat k given k minus 1 gamma uk plus some constant gain matrix into ek, where ek is actually yk minus c x hat k given k minus 1. So I have written it in a different form, it is the same equation. Okay, now I am going to just remove this you know k plus 1 given k, k given k minus 1, I am just going to remove all that complex notation. I am going to use the same notation that we used at the end of system identification. Okay, so this actually, this form of model is called as innovation form of state space model. Here you have phi k xk plus gamma uk plus L times ek, ek is defined by this equation, yk is equal to c xk plus ek. This kind of a model, this kind of a model form is called as innovation form of state space model. It is driven by, we have shown that ek is a white noise sequence, we have shown that ek is a white noise sequence, and so ek is a white noise sequence, ek in our case are innovations. We have shown that innovations is a zero mean white noise sequence, we have proved that earlier. Okay, so it's a zero mean white noise sequence with known covariance, we also had an estimate of p, how to compute p. So if I just take Laplace transform, if I had a q transform of this, I'll get nothing but you know we have done this earlier. If I just take q transform of this, this is nothing but the Box-Jenkins model. Okay, so these two are one and the same. So I arrived at it completely differently. Earlier what we had done, we developed Box-Jenkins model first and then we developed state realization. Now I am coming to Box-Jenkins model through another route. I developed Kalman filter, then I developed stationary Kalman filter, and then I said if I take its transform you get Box-Jenkins model. Okay, so it's a loop. Once I started from this end and came to this end, now I am starting from this end and going back here. Okay, so I am just showing you that the stationary Kalman predictor is nothing but a form of Box-Jenkins model. Okay, it's a form of Box-Jenkins model. So there is a deeper connection between time series models, particularly when you are modeling unmeasured disturbances. Okay, and now will you understand it within this course? No, it's very difficult. It will take some time to seep in. It took me many years to understand these connections. Unfortunately, the books which talk about time series modeling do not talk about Kalman filters. The books which talk about Kalman filter do not talk about time series modeling. And then you have to read both and make connections. Leung's book, he does make these connections, but he makes it in an exercise. So unless you happen to go and solve exercise problems, you know, you don't see those connections. And but just keep this in mind that when you are developing a time series model, actually it's a way of developing a form of Kalman filter. And other way around, a Kalman filter, stationary Kalman predictor or Kalman filter can be shown to be related to the Box-Jenkins models. So why I'm saying Box-Jenkins, it's generalized form. It could be Rmax, it could be Rx. So all those are just parameterizations. But so identifying these models is somehow equivalent to so one could say that Kalman predictor could be directly identified from data, and I don't have to go through first principles, then WK, VK characterization, then Kalman gain computations. I can directly develop a Box-Jenkins model and then I have a Kalman filter. So that is another viewpoint. It's completely data driven way of getting a Kalman, stationary Kalman filter or stationary Kalman predictor. So you can always instead of doing this, you can always directly identify it from time series data. How do you go? What do you do when the model is nonlinear? Okay, that is done using, I'm just going to mention it in 2 minutes. We don't have time to go over this. If you have a, see, we did linearization, okay, and then we developed an observer using linearized models. But in reality, most of the systems are not linear, they are nonlinear. And then you need to use nonlinear models, okay. So actually, Kalman's development, I have uploaded, by the way, those papers, the seminal papers which have given rise to this entire area. So Kalman's paper talked about linear systems. That problem was, it was a low hanging fruit. It was very difficult to come to that point where, you know, you could come up with those recursive solutions which are so elegant. But after that, that triggered research on what do you do when the model is not linear, okay. And that has given rise to entire area of state estimation. So the simplest thing that came up first was called as extended Kalman filter. Extended Kalman filter is where you try to use same update formula or gain calculation formula as Kalman filter, but through local linearization of the nonlinear model. And I have just summarized it here very, very quickly. So you just do these equations for gain calculations remain same, except that phi and gamma is computed by locally linearizing the nonlinear model at every time point. Okay, it's a kind of merging the two by using some approximations. And I have uploaded one very nice review paper by Chen, which actually talks about entire development of state estimation from say 50s to now. A very, very exhaustive review, and that probably you should attempt if you want to do research in that area. One of the very nicely written reviews. So EKF will just showing you an example. If I do EKF now with linear model, what happens is you can use it only in a small range around the operating point where you are linearized. Nonlinear model you can use everywhere. I am just showing you here over a wider range. I can use state estimation using this extended Kalman filter. In extended Kalman filter, I am going to use nonlinear differential equations directly in my prediction step. In the update step looks similar. See, what is different? The update step is same. Okay, the prediction step here in extended Kalman filter is nothing but directly using nonlinear differential equations. Okay, that's what it means. I have written it in a little bit abstract form, but this prediction step, instead of using linear difference equation, linearized model, we use the nonlinear differential equation directly using ODE45 or whatever, Euler integration or implicit Euler, explicit Euler, whatever. Okay, so this is estimation of another example, a tubular reactor. This is a system in which a reaction is carried out from some A goes to B goes to C, and typically in such systems, what you want to know is how the concentration is changing as a function of length and as a function of time. This is a distributed parameter system. Concentration of the reactants A, B and C are changing as a function of time. You can only measure temperature, Okay, but temperature is also changing as a function of time along the length. So this is a problem which is more complex than the four tank problem. So you can place only few temperature measurements along the length of the reactor. This is like a, think of it as a tube in which the reaction is being carried out. Okay, now I want to know how the profile inside changes as a function of time. I can use partial differential equations in my prediction step. These are coupled partial differential equations that talk about how concentration and temperature are related and so on. If you solve them together, you can develop a software sensor that actually shows you profile inside just based on temperature measurements. Okay, so I am merging temperature measurement data with the model predictions online in a computer. Okay, and then this is some MTech students work where we actually use this to generate concentration profiles inside. Some details are given here, and there are unknown disturbances in the feed concentration and feed flow rate, and then this is the exit concentration. I am interested in what is the purity of the product, but I can only measure temperatures, I cannot measure concentrations. So I have used these partial differential equations online, solution of partial differential equations, merged it with the temperature measurements through Kalman filter, Kalman gain calculations, and I am just estimating the concentration. This is how the profile of concentration changes as a function of time. So this is at time 1 minute, this is at time 5 minutes, and the profile goes to a steady state after some time. So so using this model based technology, you can actually see what is happening inside. You can see you can reconstruct a state of see, ultimately all these things are used in all kinds of image reconstruction, and because you only get certain measurements, you have a model and then you reconstruct what is inside. Okay, so this is one example where we have, this is an experimental work where this setup I think I had shown you earlier. There are two tanks in series, there is a heater here, and I am mixing hot water and cold water. This is a simple system that you would have in your bathroom. You have a heater, water heater, and then you are mixing water from cold tank and a hot tank, and you want a temperature, particular temperature for your water for bath. Okay, so this is my problem is to control temperature and level in this particular tank. The problem is here, one problem that we faced while developing the state estimator here is that the heat transfer from this tank wall to the outside changes as a function of time. In the daytime it is different, night time it is different. It is different when the fan is working, when the fan is not on. If 5 fans are on, if 2 fans are on, if 1 fan is on, the heat transfer to the atmosphere is different. Okay, and the model changes. So what we did was, we wanted to monitor online the rate at which the heat transfer is changing. It is not a directly measurable parameter. Okay, but through model, what we have done is that see, this is the tube, the heat transfer model that we have developed under one particular condition. We multiplied this by an effectiveness factor, some alpha, and we say that this alpha can change with time. Okay, and we just added this alpha as an extra state that can be estimated using this measurements. And then I am showing you here this effectiveness factor, heat loss parameter we called it. Okay, and this heat loss parameter I can track. Okay, so when the heat loss parameter was wrong, there was a difference between the estimated temperature and the true temperature. After some time, so observer is able to estimate things that are not directly measurable. That is what I want to point out here. This is experimental work. This is again the same MTech students experimental work. So there was a mismatch here, and after the mismatch was closed, okay, after I corrected for the wrong parameter in the model online, I could get good estimates of temperature. So there are many issues here in state estimation. What to do, how to deal with plant model mismatch. I am doing all these things under the assumption that the model is perfect. Typically the model is not perfect. Now what do? Even if it is perfect in the beginning when you start your observer, after some time the model can become bad. See, for example, in chemical plants, what happens is there is fouling. Okay, some deposits take place. You know what is fouling. If you have used the immersion heater, if you have ever used the immersion heater, in the beginning it is, you know, very nice and no deposits. But after some time, if the water is bad, there are deposits, and the rate at which the heat is transferred to the water changes. Okay, so there is a model plant mismatch. If you develop a model in the beginning, that will not work after some time. So you need to change the model. How do you estimate the measurement noise and state noise? Golden question. Okay. Recently, one of my students completed his PhD on this part. How do you estimate noise from data? Then there are issues like observability. How many extra parameters you can estimate from given set of data? What if data is missing? Okay, what if there is multi-rate data? Okay, in wireless sensors, packet losses occur. Okay, in some situations, for example, some concentrations, they cannot be measured at the same rate as you can measure temperature. So there are multi-rate systems. Okay, so you can modify all this for dealing with multi-rate systems, for dealing with packet losses, for reconstructing when measurements are lost. All these things can be done using filtering ideas, and it's a vast area of research. Even though the research has been going on in this recursive estimators for 50 years, I don't think we have the solution. There's enough scope for doing lot more. Okay. Yes, there are some fundamental results. At least for linear system theory, you can prove it. For nonlinear case, there are no proofs. Yes, because there is a rank condition which violates. If you have one measurement and if the system is observable, then you can only estimate one more extra state. You cannot estimate two. I can give you a reference where but how does it translate when you go to a nonlinear system is not clear. Okay, because local observability, what it means in terms of a global observability for nonlinear system is not very perfectly linear system. Linear system, you can prove this, that you cannot estimate more. Particularly, well, I'll just put one rider. Particularly when you model the extra states as an integrated white noise. If it is not an integrated white noise, I don't have a clear answer. If it is integrated white noise, that is how typically it is modeled, extra states. The parameter that we estimated, that effectiveness parameter, we modeled as an integrated white noise. So we have two measurements. We can estimate two extra parameters, not more than that. If you try to estimate in the sense what, you can uniquely estimate. See, if you start estimating more parameters, you will get some values, but those are not unique. The answer is not unique. I am talking about unique estimation or unique reconstruction. This is independent of whether it is Leonberg or Kalman filter. This is a filtering issue generally. This is a system property for linear systems. First of all, dynamic model based observers can be used to reconstruct unmeasured states from frequently measured outputs, and Kalman filter, of course, one of the most elegant solutions when you know the noise models. It can be used, extended Kalman filtering can be used when the system is nonlinear, and these belong to the class of so called Bayesian state estimators. It's a very wide class of observers. The new names or the new buzzwords in this area are particle filtering and ensemble filtering and so on. These are used everywhere. This filtering is now used in robotics, it's used in target tracking, radar applications, speech recognition, image reconstruction. So actually what I have taught you here is not just limited to process control or to control. This is developing a soft sensor for states that cannot be directly measured, but you have a model for it. How do you reconstruct, how do you merge observations which are available online with a model and create a software sensor, or soft sensor, I should not call it software sensor, a model based sensor. Popular word to industry would be a soft sensor or software sensor. For you guys, it should be a state estimator or an observer. Okay. So these are the nice references. Soderstrom, if you want to go deep into this area, Soderstrom's book is excellent. This is a recent book. The book by Gelb is also one of the standard references for Kalman filtering. And Astermann Wittenmark, of course, gives you. So this brings us to end of this lectures on state estimation. And I'll just preempt you now with where I want to move next. Well, where I want to move next, I'll just take 5 minutes to talk about this. We'll start these all the lectures for the next time. I'm going to talk about now control. So now just take a look at what we have done. We started by saying, we want to develop control relevant models. We had two ways of developing control relevant models. One, if I have a mechanistic model, I linearize and develop a control relevant model, which is linear difference equation. If I don't have, I start from data and then derive a linear difference equation state space model, which I can use for developing a controller. Then in between, before we went to controller design, we talked about this observer. Observer is using just the measurements, reconstructing the state vectors. Okay, now I'm going to complete this whole thing. So remember one thing, when you did modeling, you had an interface with the real world, because model is trying to mimic the real world. Moment you come to observer and controller design, you are in the world of models. This is the imaginary world. Okay, here first of all you are looking at linear models. Okay, all linear results are valid, linear algebra you can use. So it's a very nice universe where you can do manipulations, you can place poles, you can do all kinds of things. And then you design the controller in this linear space, linear model space, and then the problem comes is how do you implement this, that is realization through a hardware, that is done through a computer. So you go back to the real world by implementing the observer controller into the. So now why I talked about observer, why I talked about now controller afterwards. I am going to talk about what is called a state feedback controller. So state feedback controller assumes that is a state measurement available, full state measurement is available. In practice what is available is only some measured values. But then I have shown you how to reconstruct the states. So now assume that the state can be reconstructed, I have state measurements available. Now how do I design a feedback controller if all the states were measured? Okay, that is the next question that I want to answer. Okay. So what is the outline of this? I am going to talk about motivation. Then there is going to be this part, I can go a little faster than observer, because you will find that this is like a two mirror images. There I talked about observability, here I will talk about something called reachability. Okay, which is a very very similar concept. There the idea was, can I estimate states from the measurements? Now I will talk about, can I take the state from anywhere to anywhere? That is called reachability. Okay, so I will talk about reachability. Then we talked about pole placement observer, I will talk about pole placement controller. Same idea, transform the system to controllable canonical form. There we did observable canonical form. I am going to transform it to controllable canonical form and do controller design. Okay, so just a parallel, it's very very straightforward. Well, when we went to multiple input multiple output systems, we did not pursue with pole placement, we went to optimization based formulation. I am going to go to optimization based controller design, which is linear quadratic optimal control. Okay, so this is going to be the parallel there. Okay, so just one to one mapping you can do. Then I am going to talk about this technology, model predictive control, which is a practical technology which is implemented in the plants. And we will also see whether this my friend who actually implements this, he can give one or two lectures of actually how he does it practically on real, very, very complex plants, so that you will get to know that how it is done. And so this is complete cycle. So this with this course, you should know at the end, starting from scratch, even if you don't have any model, you can develop model from data, you can develop state estimator, combine it with a controller, and then you know how the whole thing is done, the entire cycle. So we are not missing any point in the life cycle of controller synthesis, from model development to controller synthesis. We'll do all that, and then we'll start talking about these developments. So the only one slide I'll show here before I close this. So given the state space model and controller design, is that we assume that all the states are measurable, okay, and design the controller, okay. Then we design a stable estimator. Actually, we did the step 2 first. We design a stable estimator, and then what we do is we combine the two, we marry the two. So estimator will reconstruct the states. Using reconstructed states, you implement the control law, okay. So and then we will have what is called a separation principle, where you can show that you can independently design observer and controller to be stable, the joint system will be stable. So that I will show. So why I am working with state space? Because I can work seamlessly, talk about single input, single output, multiple input, multiple output, everything can be done under one framework, okay. And it's all linear algebra, so it's very, very easy to implement. So this is what is going to be my next, say, 3 or 4 lectures. I'll complete this. And if you ask me what is the next computing assignment, we implement Leuenberger observer and Kalman filter. What is the next assignment? We implement LQG controller and model predictive controller. Whatever we do, we just go and study on that particular system. Okay.